All right. So welcome everyone to this masterclass, which will be spent on whether or not we should audit owner-managed business firms differently than other firms, like bigger firms. An intriguing question, because you know there's quite some debate also on the accountant here in the Netherlands about that particular question. Whether that should be the case or not. Should there be differences in audit and audit standards? And that is exactly the research that the research team led by Jeroen Saris is going to talk about. Jeroen will present, but his project is also run together with Mahmoud Gaad from Lancaster and Robin Litjes from Tilburg University. And Jeroen is going to give an introduction today. I guess, Jeroen, that if people interrupt, that that you won't mind, that you will, that they will every now and then interrupt. But otherwise, it's your show, so you should tell.
I'm fine with that. Right. So great. Anyone feel free to interrupt if you have any questions.
Right. Yes. So So it's really great that we can have this masterclass. And I'm really looking forward to what you're going to tell, because this is something that I have discussed a lot as well, and I'm really curious about what you have to say about this project, Jeroen. So the floor is yours.
Okay. Yes. Thank you, Jan. So thanks for the introduction, and welcome everyone to this masterclass. So one request that I first would like to make is that whether people would like to turn on their cameras, right? That makes it a bit more interesting for me as well, to see some faces instead of just initials. So if everyone would like to do that, that would be much appreciated. Then you would also see my my presentation on my share screen, and so I hope you already took the effort to go to www.menti.com to answer this question. So this is a research question that was proposed by the Foundation for Auditing Research. So does the owner-managed business environment call for different audits and different auditing standards? And so before I want to proceed with the masterclass, I would like to know your opinion on this. So please go to the website and give your opinion, whether you think it should or it should not. So I'll give you a few seconds to answer these questions, and then I'll continue. Though something doesn't seem to be working, because the slide isn't updating the question results.
Jeroen, I did cast the vote on my mobile phone. So.
No, because I have a second screen open. And I do see indeed votes coming in, but apparently in PowerPoint it's not updating the slide. So now it is, but not completely. Yeah. So apparently the plugin isn't working perfectly. But anyway, let me continue. So a few of you have answered the question, and at least the majority is in favor of having different auditing standards. So I want to get back to that later on. So this is sort of the objective of this research project, whether or not this is desirable. And I guess, of course, I don't know who answered this question, but it seems that at least the people from the profession might be in favor of this. So just briefly repeating what John already said. So this was one of the research proposals posted by FAR. So what I wanted to know was, it was entitled Different Audits for Different Purposes, or Does the Owner Managed Business Environment Call for Different Audits and Different Audit Standards? So we applied for this proposal, and we slightly reformulated the research project. I guess it will also become clear later on why we did it like this. So we sort of more want to focus on whether the audit serves a different purpose for the private owner managed firm. We want to stay away from the audit standards, as I will explain later on. And as Jan already mentioned, so this is in cooperation with Robin Litchens from Tilburg University and Mahmoud Gard from Lancaster. I'm already going to cover myself by saying that Robin and Mahmoud are much more experienced auditing researchers than I am. And also Robin has some experience in practice as well before he switched to academia. Also, what I would like to stress is that the current status of our project is still a work in progress. So we're still finalizing the data collection process. So data collected by the accounting firms who are member of FAR are working hard to collect the data. And so some firms have collected the data, others we're still waiting for it. But it's still a work in progress, so I cannot show you final results of the study, but I can show you some preliminary analysis of the data at the end. So the fact that it was work in progress also was a bit of a puzzle to me, how I wanted to approach this masterclass. So I was sort of thinking about, is it going to be a literature review? So where I show you what we know about auditing in the private firm sector, what research has done in this respect, and show you some of those results. But in the end, I thought that was maybe a little bit boring, right? And I would just overload you with facts. And I also would like to trigger a bit of your critical thinking. So I took a bit of a different approach. So I'm going to show a few research results. So there are a few papers I want to discuss with you in a little bit more detail. But I also want to take maybe a bit of a more critical perspective on the research question itself. So the program for this class is going to be as follows. So first, I want to take a more critical view to the research question and maybe also discuss some of these issues with you. I want to briefly explain sort of the approach that we take in our research project on the audit. And so that's our focus on internal and external value. So these are somewhat abstract concepts introduced in the auditing literature. But I think they are useful for our research. And it's, I guess, maybe also useful to explain how we want to approach our setting. So these are sort of the two dimensions of the audit that we're going to consider. And then I want to discuss a few studies related to voluntary audits. So these are settings where firms can choose whether to purchase an audit or not. And also studies where you could sort of say that there might be different types of audits or auditors. So these are settings where firms can choose, let's say, the auditor quality or the type of certification that the auditor has. And the main reason why I want to discuss these two streams of or these two settings is that it seems to come very close to the research question of our project, right? Whether you want to have differentiation in the audit market. But they also want to argue that they are close, but they are not actually useful to analyze the research question. And so at the end, I briefly introduce our approach and show you a few descriptives before we conclude. So that's the program for today. And as we already mentioned at the start, and what Jan also mentioned, so if you have any questions, feel free to interrupt. Okay, so then let's turn to the first part, so the research question. So the way it was formulated by FAR is, does the owner-managed business environment call for different audits and different auditing standards? And that's also the question I posed to you and that some of you answered. And maybe at first sight, the research question may be quite straightforward, and I guess everyone interprets it as, okay, do we need market differentiation in the audit market? But when I was preparing this masterclass, and again, I was going over this research question and I was thinking about it more carefully. It also raised a couple of questions with me. So maybe the first one is just, what's an owner-managed business? Might seem obvious, but you could still debate about who is the owner, especially if you're not a majority shareholder, or when is the owner also a manager? This is not the question I want to elaborate on a lot, but the following questions I think could be a lot more interesting. So what are different audits? What are different auditing standards? What's the difference between the two, right? So is there any difference between the different audit and different auditing standards? And finally, why is the foundation of auditing research or the audit industry interested in this? So in the first part of this masterclass, I would like to elaborate some more on these questions. To start with the second one. So what are different audits? So maybe I would also like to pose this question first, maybe to you, to the participants. So if anyone has a suggestion in this respect, how we should interpret the term different audits.
Yeah, I guess with regard to the object of the audit, right? I mean, an owner manager is, for instance, someone that is somewhat of a different owner than, for instance, a shareholder that nobody knows.
Yeah, no, yeah, that's true. But still, I mean, if you just look at the concept of an audit, right? I mean, then how should we interpret different audits?
I would say make a distinction between a general purpose audit, which is which results in an opinion which is fit for a general purpose, versus an audit which is geared towards the specific need of the one who assigned the auditor to do so. But that's how I would interpret different audits. So they're more tailored to the needs of the one who assigned the auditor.
Okay, but that would still, I mean, I guess it does sort of fit my story, but it does sort of suggest that there might be different objectives for the audit, right?
Robert Neck will always say there are different ways to climb the mountain. But the ultimate result is always, in principle, the same, because you need to deliver high quality audit. So yes, in that regard, an audit is an audit, but there are different ways to climb the mountain.
That's true, but then my first question would be, indeed, then what's the audit? What's an audit, right?
Do you make a distinction between the audit of the financial statements versus non-financial information, or between PIs and non-PIs?
Yeah, well, I guess so that was the thing I was thinking about when I was thinking about this, because I then also started searching the internet a bit and see what kind of definitions you find about audits. And you come across different definitions, but generally speaking, I guess this is one of the, this sort of the common denominator that you usually find. So it's indeed about the audit with respect to the financial statements, and so that the auditor should form an opinion about whether the financial statements present a true and fair view. And so in this respect, the primary purpose of the audit would be then to provide assurance or to provide reliability to the financial statements. And so from that perspective, if you would then think about different audits, my conclusion would then be, okay, different audits then mean maybe different levels of assurance. Right? So maybe you want to have 95% assurance level or 90% assurance level. If you can indicate this precision level, that did this precisely in the first place, of course. But that's maybe one perspective you could take on an audit. The alternative, and I guess that's maybe to some extent also indicated here by some of you, is, yeah, well, maybe there are also some other purposes, which I labeled here as secondary purposes. So I'm also revealing to some extent my preferences, right, or my opinion on what an audit should be. But in an audit, I mean, there's some other activities that also take place. You have critical review of the business process, and there may be some other activities that could be very useful for the company. And if you would take that perspective, then maybe an audit is a little bit more than just providing assurance. And then in that context, maybe a different audit is that you look at, okay, what kind of activities should be part of the audit? And maybe some activities could be assurance activities, but maybe also some non-assurance related activities. But I think in any case, right, it shows that, at least based on the research question, it's not completely clear what we're after here, right? So what precisely, or how should we define different audits? How should we interpret it? Is this different levels of assurance, or is it that an audit is a lot more than just providing assurance, and you may also provide other services to the company as part of the audit? And I also don't really have an answer to this question. But it is something, I guess, that does play a role in tackling this research problem, is how do you define an audit, and what do you perceive as different types of audits? Then, of course, the same question you could ask about, okay, what are different auditing standards? And at first sight, you could say, okay, well, that's obvious, right? I mean, if you would just look at the auditing standards and they are different, you could say, well, we have different auditing standards. But on second thought, and then maybe I might also get back to the remark that Anne made, or what Robert Nickel usually would say. I mean, one interpretation about different auditing standards that you could also take is that, well, you could have different auditing standards, but they all provide the same level of assurance, right? So it's, I guess, sort of equivalent to saying, well, you have different ways to climb the mountain, but in the end, you always have to climb the mountain. But then you could also say, okay, I mean, if the level of assurance is still the same, why would you care about different auditing standards? Right? If the final objective is the same, why would we bother? So another perspective you could take on these different auditing standards is then, of course, the opposite, is that if you have different auditing standards, is that they provide different levels of assurance. And again, it's not completely clear how we should interpret it in this context, although intuitively, I would think it should be the latter, right? So if you think about different auditing standards, especially maybe in the context of different types of firms, like owner-managed firms or maybe smaller firms compared to larger firms, that you may want to have different sets of auditing standards that provide different levels of assurance, right? So maybe for publicly listed companies, you want to have a higher level of assurance than for smaller firms or privately owned firms. Then, the thing that I found most puzzling when thinking again about this research question is, well, what's the difference between the two, right? Because the research question refers to both, right? I mean, do we want to have different audits and maybe also different auditing standards for these owner-managed business? But then what's the difference? So one thing you could say, well, maybe there is no difference, right? The audit or the auditing standards, or the auditing standards fully characterize what the audit is. But then again, you may wonder why use both in the research question. So then we only need to think about whether the audits are different. But if they are different, then that would also suggest, right, that an audit is characterized by more than just the auditing standards. And I guess if you look at practice, then I think that's probably also the case. I mean, you have a lot of auditing standards, but these auditing standards do not say prescribe for the full 100% what activities you should take and what activities you shouldn't take, right? So there's still a lot of discretion in these auditing standards, and they also rely a lot on professional judgment, the extent of the assessments or testing that you need to do, right? So it's up to the auditor's professional judgment to decide when there's enough evidence or when there's a risk or when maybe some additional testing has to take place. So that already suggests that an audit is characterized by more than maybe just the auditing standards. And in that case, it would mean that auditing standards are not exactly the same as the level of assurance, right? Because there's also the auditor that enters the picture, and the auditor or the auditor's expertise can also influence what the level of assurance is going to be within the same set of auditing standards. Also, if you look more recently at the Stuurgroep Publiek Belang, so that was part of the actions taken to improve, let's say, audit quality, and also part of the reform of the industry. So they published a green paper on the definition of audit quality. And there you also see that audits and auditing standards are probably not the same thing, right? So they also define audit quality on the basis of multiple dimensions. So they also take a multiple stakeholder perspective, where they have different stakeholders like the public interest, but maybe also regulators, oversight bodies, of course the client, the firm who hires the auditor. And then again, it's maybe the audit process, sort of a compliance context. So if you look at that, say that maybe the level of assurance is maybe only related to the public interest, right? So this is maybe the stakeholder that cares about assurance. Then here again, you would see that maybe auditing is more than just about providing the level of assurance. But then still the question is, what precisely then is the purpose of the audit, right? So that's also, when I was preparing this masterclass, a question that I could not really find a clear answer to. Yeah, so on the one hand, right, when we think about auditing, it's about providing assurance. That's relatively clear. But then if you look, or if you think about different audits and different auditing standards, and Also, if you look at, like, say, the multi-stakeholder perspective of audit quality. But similarly, I mean, if you look at the PCAOB, they also have an overview of audit quality measures, and they have around, I think, 28 to 30 measures. It also clearly suggests that maybe auditing is perceived as a lot more than just providing assurance, but it's not very clearly specified what all these other aspects are. So I guess that might also be a bit of a challenge in thinking about, okay, how should we interpret a different audit, and to what extent does it relate to, should we have different auditing standards or not? Then the final question, and of course, maybe I'm not the proper person here to answer this question, is why is the Foundation of Auditing Research or the audit industry interested in this question? So I'm just going to give my perspective on this, so that's my best guess. So I want to stress here that this is my opinion, and if I'm completely wrong here, then feel free to interrupt. So I can think of several reasons why the audit industry would be interested in this. So one could be maybe sort of a social perspective, right? So if you have differentiation or different certification levels, then maybe you might eliminate some inefficiencies in the market. For example, in the extreme case that you would have only one certification level, you might have overqualified auditors for relatively small firms. Yeah, so to illustrate this in a very stylized way, so if you would look at sort of what skills are required for an auditor to provide a certain level of assurance to a company, then it seems reasonable to assume that, of course, for small firms, your skills can be lower than when you have a very large or like a publicly listed company, right? So larger companies engage in more complex transactions, they are larger, more business units are involved. So your skills are an auditor to provide a proper audit for these firms should be much higher. So you only have one level of certification. And so let's take the Dutch example. So suppose you would only have the register accountant, then they would have very high auditing skills, but that would mean that if they would also be auditing very small companies, then these auditors, of course, are overqualified. And so you could argue that this is too costly, right? It's a waste of resources to have these highly skilled auditors audit rather small firms. And of course, that could be a reason maybe that you also want to have some lower certification level. But then again, we already have that in the Netherlands. So we also have the AA auditor or accountant. And this auditor is also allowed to perform the statutory audit for firms. So given that we already have these two, let's say, certification or auditor levels, then the question is, okay, why would they want to have more differentiation? So is it that they are interested in this? Is that maybe they want to have an even lower level of certification? So maybe an auditor that might only be designated to audit the really small companies and who may not be skilled or equipped to audit medium to large companies. So that's maybe one possible reason why I can think of why the industry would be interested in differentiation, and that maybe the current level of differentiation in the Dutch market is not enough, so that there should be more differentiation, and then particularly at the lower end of the market. So that's one reason. So the second reason I could think of is that I think some aspects that were already mentioned is that, especially for these owner-managed businesses, is that they would like maybe to have more from the auditor than just assurance, right? So that they value their financial expertise and that they could help improve business processes. So they may not be that much interested in a high assurance level, but they're more interested in how the auditor can improve the business processes or how they can help identify maybe certain business risks or how they can help in solving maybe some internal control issues. And so from that perspective, you could argue, well, maybe what they want is that the audit, or let's say the statutory audit, also becomes a more attractive service to sell to the smaller firms. And that if you have maybe different auditing standards and different audits, that maybe focus less on assurance, but maybe more on non-assurance services, they might be able to generate more revenues, right? So that they can make their product or service more attractive to this part of the market. And finally, the other one I could think of is maybe more of a compliance perspective, is that when you would have different auditing standards, and then in particular when you would have lower auditing standards, then maybe cost of compliance is lower, and that maybe would also reduce the cost for the auditing firms, but maybe also the workload. So they could maybe focus less on compliance issues, but maybe more on actual audit and other services that they provide. And I guess maybe there are other reasons people could think of.
Jeroen?
Yeah?
There's quite some chats on... There's quite some chatting going on as well. And maybe, I mean, I think that Robin is also looking after that. But maybe it's good to also discuss what is on the chat a bit in that respect.
Okay, I can have a look at that.
Sorry for interrupting, but I thought it was interesting, you know, the discussion that was...
that's true. I couldn't completely keep track of all what everything that was going on in the chat. So I hoped that people would just interrupt me if they would have some issues to add to the discussion.
Yes, but I mean, you know, if someone wants to ask a question, so Martijn, you had some comments that you made. Maybe that's interesting. Martijn, can I give you the floor, maybe?
Yes. I have to scroll back in the chat. Indeed, what developed over the last minutes, but. I mentioned that different audits are actually providing different services, and different auditing standards is different ways to deliver that product. So that was an initial comment, which triggered a lot of other comments. And I'm now focused on one what Christian Hofman said. Is it an idea of training auditors somewhat similar to training of pilots who first fly small planes before certified by largers? And I said, no, I don't think so. I was also a bit triggered by your slide, which there are lower skills required for smaller audits. I would say there are different skills required for smaller audits. And to take the idea of Christian, I would say you train one pilot to fly in a helicopter, and you train other pilots to fly in jet planes. So it's not first try a small one and then you get qualified for the other. I would say there are different skills needed, especially for smaller audit firms. It's more important to have some advisory skills within your tool set compared to when you audit public interest entities. So that is a summarizing a bit of the comments to make. And so I leave now room for
that. I can see that point. And I see the comparison, like with flying maybe a jet plane or flying a helicopter. I'm not experienced in that, so I don't know to what extent, say, that the skills of flying a helicopter overlap with flying a jet plane. But another question you could ask is, And I think maybe that relates also to one of the earlier questions that I raised is, what precisely do you want from an audit, right? What Because you also mentioned that, okay, like maybe for a smaller firm, like an owner-managed business, we want to have more consultancy-like services. But the question is, should that then be part of the audit? I mean, if firms need these services, right, they can just buy them on the consultancy market. So the question then would be is, why should that be part of the audit or part of the auditing standards that auditors do that, right? Or why would you have to train an auditor that, say, is focused on the smaller firms or the owner-managed businesses? Should he be trained in giving consultancy services as part of the certification that he needs to do the audit, right?
Yeah, referring to the slide which is on the screen, I would say that would increase the added value of the audit from the perspective of the owner-managed business.
Yes, but the question is whether you should sort of change the definition of what an audit is and what it should be, whether you should change it for that, right? I mean, if as long as the auditor would be allowed to provide these consultancy services, there is not really a need, I think, in my opinion, right, to change what an audit should be.
I'm not sure whether I subscribe to that. I mean, when you are an auditor, you have to really, really know the business model, how it works, because otherwise you cannot make sense of the economic events to the extent that you need to actually do the audit. So, and as a byproduct, I would say, right, you are also able, and you're also able to tell management what you think about the function of the business model. That is just part of your job as well. Whether it is the main purpose of the audit, that I don't know. Maybe it is because, you know, to an extent you also give information to management that they can use to their benefit, increasing the likelihood that the firm will survive. But at least, right, I mean, it comes from the fact that when you do the audit, you have to really know the business model very well.
So that's true, but that's also part of, let's say, the skills of an auditor, right? I mean, that's also in the auditing standards. I mean, that auditors should spend sufficient amount of effort in understanding the business and the industry. If that's important, then it's not clear why you would want to change the audit or the auditing standards for that, because that's a skill that they already should possess currently. That's and cool. So I guess one of the major questions and is indeed what precisely do you want from the audit, right? What's the objective of the audit? Is that just providing assurance, or is it indeed also providing other services to make this audit service more attractive to your clients? But then the second question is, do you want to formalize that in different auditing standards or in different education and different, maybe also certification standards? Now, the latter is not really part of our research, right? But I think it is related to the research questions about how much differentiation do you want to have in this market? But given that I'm already running a little bit behind my schedule, let me continue. So I guess at least maybe based on the amount of feedback that I've seen is that maybe the economic perspective is maybe one of the important ones, and that also if you think about what's an audit is that the industry at least perceives it as more than just providing assurance to the financial statements, right? So that there might also be something like non-assurance services or consultancy services that that might add value to the clients as well. And to some extent, that's also sort of the theoretical approach that we want to take in how we see the audit in our research setup. So that's what I want to briefly explain in the next part. So that's about the internal and external value of the audit. So this part is based on a study by Nekel, Nimi and Sundgren of 2008. So that study makes this distinction between internal and external value of the audit. And I guess this is maybe only one distinction that you could make. I guess this is not the only one. But we sort of chose for this one because it sort of differentiates only two dimensions, so that that keeps it rather transparent. And I guess also maybe from a research perspective, I guess the two dimensions are a bit better, especially to differentiate between the owner managed business and let's say the larger firms or the publicly listed firms. So the internal value of the audit refers to the value that the audit provides to the internal stakeholders, which we interpret as firm management. So these refer to benefits internal to the company and also like the consultancy services or advisory services that we already refer to. And the external value is say the assurance level, right? So it serves external stakeholders. It's about providing reliability to the financial statements. Now I see that Anne posted a message that she can't see the slides anymore. Does it also hold for other participants? Okay. Because according to my screen, the screen share is still on and working. So. So this is, at least in our research approach, the distinction we want to make between internal value and external value of the audit. And we want to look at it at the audit activity level. So we cannot say at the overall level of the audit that either the audit has internal or external value. But if you look at the individual activities that are being performed as part of the audit, you could say that either each activity has internal value, external value, or both. So, illustrating as a simple example, if you would just see the audit as a collection of activities, so the small dots are all kinds of audit activities that are being executed, and so maybe the more activities, the larger the audit. So in this case, it would be an example of that the internal value is smaller than the external value. Yeah, so we've seen fewer yellow dots than red ones. And you also see a few, in this case, two activities that maybe both serve the internal or the external value. And of course, one of the major challenges in our research, but that's something that I'm not going to address today, is of course, how are we going to assign activities to internal value or external value? And so in this case, internal value is smaller than external. But of course, it can also be the opposite way, or it could be equal. So in this case, you would have a separation of activities. So they are either internal or external, but they are same in size. But of course, you could also have something like this, that maybe all activities both serve internal or external value. So to elaborate a bit on this more, so what precisely is this internal value of an audit? So, I mean, there are more studies that have looked at this. So one I want to pick out is this one by Esplin, Jamal and Sunder. The study actually focused on auditor selection. So it was a field study with CFOs and some stakeholders. And these CFOs or firms were in the middle of changing auditors. And so it's a descriptive study on the auditor selection process, But for our purpose, what's particularly interesting is that he also looked at what CFOs or what these private firms want from an auditor. So one important question that this study focuses on is what do companies want from the auditor? And then if you look at the summary of the answers is that it's I guess it coincides with what has been mentioned before, is that they want to have an accounting and industry expert. It should focus on internal issues of the firm, like especially internal control, but they might also want to have some additional advice. One thing that was mentioned in particularly was advice on tax and tax compliance. And what was also valued highly were additional consulting services provided by the auditor. And what these CFOs also mentioned was that what they also preferred was to buy auditing and consulting services from the same provider. Yeah, so they wanted to deal with this with the same accounting firm. Yeah, so they don't really like to buy consulting services from someone else.
Jeroen, a clarifying question for the study. Were these CFOs from owner-managed companies?
That I don't know. No, it were relatively small private companies. But I don't think the study specified whether they were owner-managed. Because I think they also don't really had full control of how to get access to the CFOs. If I recall correctly, it was through an accounting firm. I think they provided access to a group of companies and CFOs, and then some of them wanted to participate. But I don't know from the top of my head precisely what the characteristics of these firms were.
Right.
So at least the main conclusion, what you could draw from this study is that if you look at what the value of the audit is for the CFOs or for the companies, is that they see the auditor primarily as part of their internal control system. So they don't really seem to care that much about assurance or the reliability of their numbers, but it's more about, I guess, the consultancy or advisory services that were mentioned before, right? That's what CFOs value the most. And I guess that's also maybe a clear example of what internal value of the audit refers to. What I also want to do with you is share a few quotes from this study, because I think that they're quite interesting, and also give, even though it's only from, of course, 11 CFOs, and I'm only going to show 3 quotes, but they might give a very interesting perspective of how these CFOs look at the statutory audit. So the first one was that one CFO said, well, how can the audit help us earn more money, right? So this is purely from an economic perspective. Providing assurance doesn't really play a role in this argument, right? They really care about the advisory or the consulting services that they can receive from the auditor. The next one is a bit longer, but in short, what it says is that the companies only want the auditors to focus on the key risk areas, right? They don't want them to focus on useless procedures, as they put it in here, like auditing fixed assets and leases, because the auditing standards prescribe them that they should do this. The companies say, well, we're paying the auditor by the hour, so they should spend these hours very useful, and they should only spend them where we perceive that there is a risk. And the third quote is even more explicit about that, because the CFO would say, well, we just have to tell the auditors where they should do the testing, right? It's not up to their discretion. We know where the risks are, and we just want the auditors to analyze this in more detail. And I guess that clearly illustrates that I think they would see the auditor more like a consultant trying to improve their business then that's really about providing assurance. And I mean, when I saw this quote, I must say I also find it a bit concerning, right? Because you would expect an auditor to be independent, and I guess also from the social perspective, that's what you want from the audit, is this assurance, this reliability. And then you would also expect auditors to maybe do some testing in areas where maybe the firms themselves don't see any risks, or maybe even in areas where firms don't want any testing to take place, right? So so this would also beg the question that even if firms would think about an auditor like this, should we change the rules or the objective of the audit just to tailor what the firms want or not? And I'll get back to that in a few minutes.
But can I quickly interrupt?
Yeah, yeah, sure. Go ahead. You can see the slides again?
Yeah. I went out to call and I came back in, and so now I can see it again. So it was on my side. I'm just thinking whether these are mutually exclusive. Because I've also done some research where I interviewed different the audit committee members, internal auditors, CFOs, and auditors. And indeed, so it reflects a little bit what you are saying here, that for some, that internal value is really important. So, for example, to make them aware of certain operational or financial risks. But the basic, that should not necessarily mean that they are not interested in the assurance itself. I mean, it's like that is the foundation, right? So because they need to have the stamp, they need to have their financial statements approved. But on top of that, they want something else. And that's different, because for certain companies, they are not interested in that part because they just consider the auditor as the kind of policeman who comes in, does the job, gives the stamp, and that's it. But others, they are really interested in having that additional awareness of what the risks are that they are exposed. But that does not mean that by definition, they are not interested in the assurance, but that, because that's the minimum, I would say.
Well, I mean, it depends, isn't it? Because
some firms are indeed not interested in a quality audit, but others are, and then it's not necessarily mutually exclusive, I would say.
No. So I'm not saying that it is, of course, mutually exclusive. But what you were referring to was, okay, it's they need to have the audit. I mean, they need to have the stamp that the audit has been performed, but that's because, at least in some settings, it's just mandated by law, right? So that they have to have it. And that's maybe also why they buy the audit. And so, as we also will see later, I mean, when you look at settings where audits can be purchased on a voluntary basis, mm-hmm. and you also see that some firms just don't buy it. And also what you mentioned is that I mean, some may not care about assurance and others do.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. But so that's
but even if they do care about assurance, then you also don't know whether it's maybe truly voluntary. I mean, it could still be that even if it's not mandated by law, I mean, it might be a creditor that requires that you
Exactly. Because they have, they derive benefits from it. So that's.
So I also don't want to say here that they don't care about assurance at all. What I want to show here is, right, that there is clearly an internal value component to the audit, right? So that based on this descriptive evidence is that these private companies indeed want to have some, besides the assurance, they also want to have some useful information or advice that's going to improve their business and help them to make more money. And so this clearly refers to the internal benefits. Okay, so we can do something similar to the external value of the audit. So I want to do this relatively quickly because I'm way behind my schedule. But there's one study by Abdel Khalik, which is a relatively old one, but I want to discuss it here primarily because it analyzed lender covenant data. So it was looking at, okay, to what extent does the lender require that the firm has an audit? So this study was based on US private companies. So for these companies, the audit is not mandatory. And so in this respect, what they find is that out of these 40 companies for which they had data, more than half the lenders required an audit from the company. Yeah, so that also is clear evidence that this assurance has value for stakeholders, so that there's an external value of the audit. And then there's another study I want to briefly show you. That's the one by Minnis and Schroff, which is more recent, which is based on a survey, and that also looks at, okay, what's the value of mandatory disclosure for private firms and the value of auditing. And so they send out a survey to private companies, also to standard setters. In this case, I'm primarily interested in what the private companies said. And so one of the questions that was posed to them is to what extent they think that users benefit from the audit of their financial statements. And so you have quite a few of users listed. And so I have two columns where private companies indicated that they believe that they would definitely benefit from the audit, or stakeholders that definitely do not benefit from an audit of the financial statements. And so again, here, if you would look at the top three, so these are the tax authorities, lenders, creditors, existing shareholders. I mean, that would clearly relate to external value of the audit. If you look at the second three, it's a bit mixed because there also current management team is included. So it also, again, is evidence that there is internal value to the audit, but also external value. And then the bottom ones, most of them are, again, external, but there the percentage that they will benefit is considerably lower. But still, these results indicate that the private companies indeed believe that quite a few external stakeholders benefit from the audit of their company statements. So now I had two other questions on the Mentimeter, but I'm going to skip that for the sake of time. So when I get back to the research question, and if you look at these two dimensions of internal and external value of the audit, like also stressed in the beginning, there are also two parts of the research question. So the one is the call for different audits, and the second one is the call for different auditing standards. And so if you look at the different audits, then I guess what we want to look at is, do we see systematic differences in how the audit is being performed, so let's say between the owner-managed businesses and other firms, like maybe larger privately owned companies or the publicly listed companies. And then what we would like to focus on is indeed these two dimensions of internal value and external value. So do we see that maybe the internal value is much more important for the owner managed business than it is for other businesses? And do we also see that the owner managed businesses indeed buy these advisory services from the auditor and not from another provider or consultancy company? The part about the auditing standards, I think, is a bit more tricky. So I think that that's more of a political issue. Yeah, so if we could analyze what happens in practice, and even if you would observe that there are systematic differences between these owner-managed businesses and other types of businesses, then it's still difficult to say, should we change auditing standards or not, right? In my opinion, I think it's more of a political question. Then the question you should raise is, should you adjust the auditing standards to what's happening in practice? Getting back to the survey study that I mentioned before and the quotes, I mean, does it mean that auditors should receive much more training in providing advice to these companies and how they can help these companies to make more money? Or should you take the other perspective in that maybe you should adjust practice to what are the socially desirable auditing standards? So if you would indeed see what we also saw maybe in the quotes, that in these owner-managed businesses, auditors may only do the testing where firms want them to do the testing, then maybe you might not get the full picture, or this is maybe not what socially desirable. And in that case, maybe you don't want to change auditing standards, or maybe you want to change auditing standards, but then in the opposite direction, right? So that auditors pay more attention to providing assurance rather than providing advice. But that's a question that's, I guess, also difficult to answer based on research, especially given the current institutional setting. So we want to stay away from this part of the question that's being posed by FAR. So what we do want to focus on is just, do we observe businesses in how audits are being performed between the owner-managed businesses and other types of businesses? And even if you do observe businesses, even if you do observe differences, then I think it might still be difficult to say what kind of practical implications you can take out of that, right? It's not clear whether that means that auditing standards should be changed or not, and if they should be changed, in what direction they should change. So we will leave that out of scope for our research project. Okay, then I want to skip this part. So let me turn to, I think, two research settings that are interesting for this research question. So the one is our research settings where audit is voluntary. So these are settings where firms can choose to purchase an audit. So it's not mandatory like in many institutional settings, because that might also give some insights on what the value of the audit is, and also what the trade-off between the internal and external value is. So if firms, presuming that firms primarily care about the internal value, they would only buy an audit when the internal value would exceed the external value. So there are various settings or institutional settings where you could analyze voluntary audit choices. So there has also been various literature on this. And what I want to just focus on are two studies from the UK. So in the UK, you have mandatory filing of annual financial statements. So one benefit of that is that you would also have data from firms that choose not to purchase an audit. And there is mandatory auditing of financial statements, but it also has some exceptions. And prior to 2004, these exceptions were relatively small. So only very small companies didn't need to have a statutory audit of their financial statements. So only companies with sales less than 90,000. So that's a relatively small company. That's a really small company, and it's also a relatively small group. So for research, I guess this setting was not that interesting. So it became much more interesting after 2004, when legislation changed in the UK and much more firms were exempted from the mandatory audit. So firms that satisfied two out of these three criteria didn't have to buy an audit, and this subset became much larger, and then it also became much more interesting for research to look into this setting. And you also see that based on, I guess, the number of researchers that jumped on this setting and the papers that have been written on the UK setting and this piece of legislation in particular. So one study I want to show you the results is the one by Dedman, Kozar and Lennox. So they indeed look at the demand for audit in private firms. And what they want to look at is which factors determine the demand for the audit. And so they look at five different factors. So these are agency cost, company risk, the requirement for additional capital, non-auditing services, and past demand for assurance. And so I've also listed, say, the variables that they use to measure this, but I'm not going into those details. What I do want to show is how these factors would relate to internal and external value of the audit. So from our perspective, like the agency costs and the requirement for additional capital primarily would have external value. Yeah, so it's about providing assurance or reliability to your financial statements. The non-auditing service factor is clearly internal value. And then the other two about company risk and past demand for assurance, it's not really clear, right? It could be both external or internal. Of course, I mean, if you look at company risk, firm management may be interested in that, but also external stakeholders are interested in what the risks are. And the same holds for past demand for assurance. If you don't know where past demand for assurance comes from, whether that's internal or external value, we cannot label this one as whether it's external or internal. The only thing you can see is to what extent it influences the choice to buy an audit voluntarily. So what I find is that most factors that they included have an influence on whether you want to buy an audit voluntarily. What is surprising to some extent is that leverage and interest coverage doesn't have an effect. So these are the, let's say, two variables related to creditors. And so in that respect, that might be a bit surprising that it are the creditors that may not be interested in an audit. One remark that I want to make in that respect is that what they measure here is whether the amount of leverage and the amount of interest coverage has an effect on the purchase of an audit. And so that does not necessarily mean that the creditor is not interested in an audit. I mean, it could also be the case that no matter how small the loan that's being provided is, that a creditor would always demand an audit. And then you would also find no relation between the amount of leverage or the amount of interest coverage on the audit purchase. And another, I think, interesting observation is that they do see that the number of voluntary audits is decreasing over the time period that they are considering. So unfortunately, it's still relatively short, so it's only for 3 years. But you do see that it's decreasing. So what precisely the reason for that is not clear. So it might also be that maybe some firms maybe just want to see how the market responds when other firms may not buy an audit, and then they will follow later on. But the paper also doesn't really shed or provide additional explanation on that. A related study, also by Lennox, but now with Pittman, it's the same setting, also looking at voluntary audits, but this study focuses on credit ratings. But what I found also interesting, especially in the context of our setting, is that they also analyzed the audit characteristics for companies that decided to opt out of the audit in 2004. So then if you would look at the results, so first the one with respect to the credit ratings, what you would see, so what they did was they split the sample into two groups. So companies that still bought an audit voluntarily in 2004 and companies that did not. So in 2003, it was still mandatory. So then all these firms bought an audit. And in 2004, let's say the blue ones, they didn't buy it. And the red ones, they did buy it. And you also clearly see that there is an effect on the credit rating. So the companies that still buy an audit, they get a higher credit rating. The ones that didn't received a lower credit rating. And so this is another, I guess, an example maybe of the external value of an audit, right? So getting assurance of getting more information about the reliability of the financial statements is valuable to the market. And in this case, it would affect the credit rating. What they also found was that a little more than 30% of the companies didn't purchase an audit voluntarily anymore. So maybe getting back to the remark made by Anne previously. So some firms still care about providing assurance, or maybe they have to do it because of their creditors. But one third of the population do not seem to have a very high value for providing assurance. I think one of the results that's more interesting for maybe the differentiation question is that when they analyzed the audit fees and the type of auditor, whether it was a Big Four or not, in 2003, then they also observed that the companies that opted out paid much lower audit fees and were also less likely to hire a Big Four auditor. So this might already suggest that in 2003, there might be some kind of differentiation in the market, that some firms were buying maybe lower quality audits, so they were paying less to the auditor, so there might have been lower audit activities, but they also hired lower quality auditors. So we could interpret this as some evidence that implicit in the market, there is some market differentiation. Yeah, so so you see some differentiation in audit fees, and especially the companies that may assign relatively low value to the assurance or to the external value part, I guess we're also able to reduce audit fees, or at least also organize the audit in such a way that it was less costly to them. Of course, what we cannot infer from this study is to what extent the companies that opted out cared about internal value, or whether the internal value was just not high enough, or whether they bought consultancy services from another provider. So summarizing, what would this setting with the voluntary audits tell us about the question that we would be interested in? Do we have different audits, or do we need different audits for different purposes? And I guess it doesn't tell us that much about that particular question, given that the choice we're looking at here is just a binary one. So either you buy an audit or you don't buy an audit. What we could infer from this is that, okay, the companies that do not buy an audit voluntarily, what we could conclude is that, okay, the cost of the audit apparently exceeds the benefit, right? So, and in the context of our internal external value setting, it would maybe suggest that the internal value of the audit is too low. But the question that we would be actually interested in is maybe this one is, would these companies have purchased the audit if the audit would have been different, right? So if they would have had different auditing standards, or maybe if an audit with maybe lower assurance level and higher internal value was available, would these companies then have bought this audit, right? If you would know this, then at least we could say more about whether we would need different audits for different purposes. In this binary setting, it's more difficult to conclude this. The only thing we can conclude is that the cost apparently exceeds the benefits. But we don't really know whether it would help to differentiate the market, right? To have maybe a second set of auditing standards that could make the audit more attractive to these set of companies. Yeah, so based on this research, we cannot really answer this question, right? We just don't know. That doesn't give us the data to analyze this. If you would like to analyze this, we need to have a setting where, at least to some extent, different types of audits or different types of auditors exist. And to some extent, there are institutional settings where we can get a little bit closer to the research question that we're interested in. Yeah, so if you look at Scandinavian countries, and in this particular example, I want to focus on the setting in Finland, is that these usually allow for sort of different type of auditors, or at least auditors with different types of certification levels, and some choices in which one you want to hire. And that might give us some more indication about what firms want to buy what type of audit or want to hire what type of auditor. So if you look at the setting, then so specifically for Finland, they have a two-tier certification system. So they have so-called KHT certification and HTM. I'm not going to explain all the details, but I think the most important one is that the KHT certification is considered to be the higher of the two. So it involves more education, and it also involves more practical experience to earn this certification than the HTM one. And in addition to these two certification levels, you also have non-certified auditors. What you also have is that filing of annual financial statements is mandatory. So it also means that you have financial data over all companies in the population. And there's also mandatory auditing. And what makes the setting interesting is that you do see some degree of differentiation in this setting. So if you look at the large companies, they are only allowed to hire a KHT certified auditor. So this is the auditor with the highest level of certification. Then if you go to the small to medium sized companies, these companies have a choice, right? They can choose between both certifications. And so that would also enable researchers to analyze what choices companies make here. So what companies want to have the higher certified auditor, what companies want to have the lower certified auditor. And for the very small companies, they have a similar choice because they don't really need certification. But of course, they still have the option to hire a certified auditor. And so here we have an example of an audit market that's somewhat differentiated. And so that also allows to analyze what choices the companies make. And maybe what's important to add here is that the auditing standards, so the requirement for the statutory auditor, statutory audit, are the same for all these companies. So there's no differentiation in auditing standards, but there is differentiation in the type of auditor that you can hire. So the paper by Nekel, Niemi, and Sundgren that already was previously mentioned and that introduced the internal and external value, it's one of a number of studies that looks at this setting, at that market differentiation. And the study is somewhat similar in approach to the Detman, Kazar, and Enoch study about voluntary audits. So they want to analyze what factors are determining the choice for audit certification level. But it differs from the Detman paper in that they classified the factors a little bit differently. So they only consider three factors, and they define Well, they consider the first two one to be internal value related, and the third one, the financial structure one, to be external value related. And so that's their interpretation. That's the interpretation of the authors. With complexity, you could say it's debatable. So if the firm is more complex, then maybe also the company may have more internal or may assign more value to consultancy services or the internal value of the audit. But on the other hand, external stakeholders like creditors may also value this. So to what extent complexity is 100% internal could be debatable, but I'm just following the authors here, and they consider it to be internal value. And so what they then do is just analyze the three types of decisions. So what factors determine the choice of the very small companies? Do they go for a certified auditor or not? For the small, medium-sized companies, they look at what factors determine whether they go for the high certified auditor or the lower one. And for the large companies that have to go for the high certified auditor, they look at whether they go for Big Six or not. So what do they find? So for the first question, for the certified auditors, for the small companies, they find that size is a determinant, salaries and sales growth and share issue. If you look at the medium-sized companies, you see the following results. And for the Big Six, it's as follows. And I guess what's important to observe is the following. Excuse me. So size is a determinant across all three, let's say, markets. So in that respect, with respect to size, these markets do not perform differently. If you look at the complexity variables, then it's a bit of a mix, but you also don't really see any consistency. So salaries pops up for the very small companies, but again, it also pops up for the listed companies. Then sales growth is only for the very small companies, but there's also not really a proper economic explanation for why this would only be determinant for the small companies, but not for the other ones. And sort of the same holds for the financial structure. So let's say the net debt or the unsecured debt is a determinant for the medium and large companies, but share issues is again only for small and the large companies. And so the paper also doesn't really provide a proper economic explanation for why they observe these differences. So it's not clear why these different results are observed. And that also makes it more difficult to observe or to conclude that differentiation happens, or on what ground differentiation happens. So if you look at this study, then I guess one issue is that although they do find some differences across the three markets, which might suggest that some differentiation is going on, there's no clear economic explanation for the difference. So we don't really understand why it happens. We only observe that there is some differences. But I guess as long as we don't really understand why it happens, then it maybe it's also difficult to use this study and related studies in this setting to say, okay, we need to change auditing standards, or maybe we need to change certification levels, or what we expect from auditors. Second, what's maybe one disadvantage of a setting like this one is that you can only observe the upgrades. Right, so the companies that do have a choice, the only choice they have is to go for a higher qualified auditor, but they don't really have the choice to go for a lower qualified auditor. And so that's, I guess, maybe interesting about the UK setting is because they had this change in legislation you were also able to see which companies preferred to have a downgrade, right? To go from, let's say, purchasing an audit because it was mandatory to a setting where it was voluntary and then they don't buy the audit anymore. That's a decision that we cannot observe in this setting. And I also don't know of any legislative changes where you could maybe analyze whether there was a downgrade or not. So this setting, I guess, only allows you to analyze one part of the story, right? So it only allows analysis for what firms may want to have a higher qualified auditor. And getting back to the discussion that we had in the beginning about what's the added value for an owner-managed business, and maybe also why the industry would be interested in this question, then it doesn't seem, I mean, the main issue doesn't seem to be that these firms want to hire a higher qualified auditor, right? It is they want to have something else from the auditor that maybe the current institutional setting is not able to provide to them. So I guess maybe, so that's one drawback of this setting. And the third one, which I think maybe is the most important one, is what precisely does the certification level of the auditor proxy for? Yeah, so what does it measure? Is it higher audit quality? Do they provide a higher level of assurance? Or what is it what you get from the higher certified auditor in this particular setting? And again, here, there are a few possibilities. So one setting you could think of is that maybe the setting is as follows. That indeed, certification levels say something about the level of assurance that these auditors can provide. So the non-certified auditor provides a low level. The low level certification provides an intermediate level of assurance, and the high level auditor or certified auditor provides a high level of assurance. And so for the very small firms, indeed, maybe this level of assurance is sufficient. And so a non-certified auditor may be sufficient. But for larger companies, you may want to have a larger certification level. So that's why you change the regulation. And for like the really large companies, you also want to have the highest assurance level. So this could be underlying this setting. The problem is that we don't really know. We don't really know what kind of assurance level that is being provided by these auditors. And another setting that could arise is the following, that maybe these certification levels all provide the same assurance level, at least for the very small companies, right? Because these companies are not very complex. And so a non-certified auditor can maybe give the same level of assurance as the high qualified auditor can do for this relatively simple company. But when you would move to a larger company, let's say the small to medium sized companies, then the non-certified auditor runs into problems, right? Then maybe his skill set becomes insufficient. And that means that once complexity of these companies increase, the non-certified auditor can no longer provide the desired assurance level, and it drops off to zero very quickly. Yeah, so in this setting, the non-certified auditor is not really equipped to audit small to large companies. And then, of course, the same story you could hold for the low certified auditors. So their skill set is good, but not good enough to audit the larger firms. And the problem is that we don't really know which of the two settings actually applies, right? We don't know whether we're in this setting or whether we're in that setting, or whether we're in a combination of the two, or maybe an even third setting that you can think of. And then that's a bit unfortunate, because if it was in the first setting, in this setting, I mean, if this would be true, then we could conclude that maybe there are different audits for different purposes, right? That for the very small firms, maybe a low assurance level is sufficient. And if companies want to have higher assurance level, they can just buy it. So then we could maybe infer that there is a need for different audits for different purposes. But we would not be able to say anything about auditing standards, right? Because they are still identical in this Finnish setting. And in this particular setting, what you could conclude is that maybe certification level sort of proxies or measures the assurance level that an auditor can provide. But if you would look at the second story, right, then we sort of have identical audits. I mean, if you look at the very small firms, then you just get the same assurance level. So in that case, we cannot really infer from these results that we have different audits for different purposes. And of course, we still have the identical auditing standards. And in this case, certification would be more a proxy of the skill set of the auditor and what kind of complexity of firm this auditor can handle to provide the desired assurance level. Yeah, so non-certified auditors can only handle very simple firms, the very small ones. For the small to medium-sized firms, you need a larger skill set, so you need some certification. And for the really large companies, you even need a larger skill set. Yeah, but in the end, it doesn't really affect the assurance level. It's more, what skills do you need to fly it or to audit a company? So to getting back to flying a plane, that was mentioned in the beginning. Yeah, if you only want to fly a Cessna, right, then maybe your skill set has to be much smaller than if you want to fly an Airbus 380, right? And but in both cases, you can fly the plane, and I guess you can, and you're also skilled to fly the plane. So sort of the assurance or the way you do it, or the risk is the same, except the skill set that you need is completely different. And so what the main problem is here is that we just don't know which of the two settings arises in practice, right? So if you look at the results of this study and other studies on this Finnish setting, is that we don't really know whether we're in this situation where we would have different audits for different purposes, or whether this might be the underlying situation. And then we cannot infer these results as that we have different audits for different purposes, because all audits are just identical. They provide the same assurance level. Yeah, so to address this issue, one thing you could do is try to analyze assurance level. So can we analyze in some way or another whether the high quality auditors or the high certified auditors provide a higher assurance level, so that we can know whether we're in this situation or in that one. But that's not the route we chose to take, because we feel it's a bit difficult to have a reliable and proper proxy for the assurance level. And that would complicate to differentiate or to distinguish between these two settings. So what we want to do in our research setting is we still want to follow the sort of the design as in the Dedman, Kazar, Lennox paper and in the Neckel, Nimi and Sudman paper. But from a slightly different perspective. So we still want to take this approach and look at, okay, what are the determinants of the variables that we're interested in? So we want to look at this trade-off between internal and external values, but we don't want to focus on this auditor certification level or on assurance levels. But we want to look more at maybe the production function or the activities that the auditor performs. So what the main assumption in our research setting is And what sort of the basis of our hypothesis is that we assume that the private owner-managed company cares more about the internal value than the external value of the audit, right? So he cares more about the consultancy services than the assurance.
Jeroen, we're running a little bit out of time.
Yeah. I can finish in a few minutes. So our reasoning is that if there's a higher demand for audit activities related to the internal value, and if auditors also provide these audit activities as part of their audit, then we should see this in the audit fee and in the labor mix of the audit activities. And so the hypothesis that we formulate does focus on audit fees and the labor mix. So if our assumption, or if privately owned or the owner-managed businesses care more about the internal value, then we would expect to see a much stronger relation between internal value and audit fees than for other companies. So if the internal value of an owner-managed business increases, then he would also like the auditor to undertake these activities, and of course he would also pay for this. Yeah, so then you would see a much stronger relation between internal value and audit fees. Compared to, for example, a publicly listed company, because maybe a publicly listed company may have an internal audit department that might take care largely for this internal value, or they might just hire a consultancy company. And the same applies with respect to the labor mix, right? So there again, we would expect that the relationship between internal value and the labor mix of the audit is much stronger for the owner-managed businesses than for other types of businesses. And so to conclude, so I'm skipping this one. A quick preview of some preliminary results. So like I mentioned in the beginning, I mean, we're still in the data collections phase, and we have received data from some companies, for some audit firms. And so we did some analysis on that. So we analyzed data for two audit firms. So you see in the first table some information about the sample composition. And what we initially looked at was the distribution of hours over the months in the year. And so we allocated those to either planning, interim, or year-end activities. And then you already see that there is some difference between private and public companies. And these differences are also marginally significant. So you see, also if you look at the graph, so here we plotted for each month individually, then you see that interim activities are much higher for the private companies compared to the publicly listed companies. And you see that the opposite holds for year-end activities. Of course, here we still only make a distinction between private and public companies. But in the end, what we would like to do is distinguish between more types of companies, among which the owner-managed business, and then see how does this labor mix differ, and can we see systematic differences in what activities the auditors perform for these companies in our sample. And on the basis of that, we hope to be able to answer the research question, to what extent differentiation in the audit happens in practice, and of course, what implications we can infer from that. I guess that's maybe a bit more challenging. And also what I tried to explain in the beginning is that maybe this might also be more of a political issue than something that we can objectively infer from our statistical results. So that's it. So I ran out of time. So this was a slide that I wanted to finish with. So it's still a work in progress. So somewhere in the future, I hope to be able to present to you again the results of our study and to what extent market differentiation actually takes place in the Dutch market. So that's it for me. So thanks a lot for your attention and your questions. So if there are still any questions, feel free. Anyone?
Well,
if not, then I guess we can conclude.
I would like to thank you very much, Jeroen, for this insightful introduction. I think, speaking from far, we are interested in, audits in smaller firms, because for one thing, we know so little of this sector, while it is so important in all of our economies, right? And what the role of the auditor is there. So your study is going to contribute to that, in terms of at least, knowing, how activities are different when it comes to these to smaller and larger firms. So we are very interested to learn this. So we're looking forward to the results of your study. I would like the participants very much today to participate in this discussion. You could actually tell also from what Jeroen said that we do know actually too little, at least systematically. Maybe individual auditors sometimes know a lot that is just not systematically collected information. And that is one of the purposes that we have at FAR. So great that you could be here. And for now, I would like to thank everyone and have a nice weekend.